Hi everyone, this is Andy Raby. We're going to go ahead and start. If you do have any questions during the webinar, please put them in the question section. I will be monitoring that the whole time and we'll get them answered as fast as we can. Thanks a lot. Here's Wayne Black.
Good morning and happy new fiscal year to you all. I thought you were going to say, here's Johnny. I mean, you have to be around a while to know, here's Johnny. My new Ed McMahon here is Andy Raby. Well, we're kicking off the new year on a fun note, aren't we? Perhaps there's reason for that. The General Assembly has concocted and passed a budget and have gone home. Perhaps some joy can come from that here in Raleigh and across the counties as well. As a matter of fact, that's really going to be one of our topics for this morning, is to talk about what is in the state budget in our different areas and implications, especially for county departments of social services. So before we get to that, again, I want to welcome everybody on the call today. Different time, you know, we moved around because of the holiday to hopefully have more folks to be able to join the call. So first of all, as far as the monthly social services updates that went out last week, Jack got that together. Again, we thought this was going to be about maybe two, three, four pages. It's rounded up about 8 pages, I think, Jack, for the last 2 months. There's a lot of information to share because there's a lot going on. I want to bring your attention to a couple of things, though. One is in here is reference to the county ADP plan, which is a requirement for counties to do. Another is reference to the NC Corals county reimbursement ledger suite. It's also on, I think it's on page 6. Make sure you note that. One thing that's not in here I want to reference is a recent Dear County Director letter. They also went to Child Support Agency directors regarding fiscal manual updates and changes. This was issued on June 30th, 2016 from the Controller's Office. I'm going to make sure everybody is aware of that. So again, if there are any questions on any items in the Social Services Monthly Updates, going forward, again, I want to reiterate that we will publish this at the end of each month. Prior to the 100 director call the following month. And if at any point in time any directors have any questions about that, you can certainly direct those questions, I think, probably to Jack Rogers and myself. And, you know, for more detail or more information, or you can go directly to the source if it's from our different divisions or budget folks or whoever. So, again, information, please share this with your team. As appropriate, so that everyone is in the loop on what's going on. All right, moving on. I want to talk a little bit about FNS in terms of where we are, in terms of performance, and most importantly, if you again read back to the updates, if we take our weekly timeliness data for the period of January through June 24th, we actually have 222,094 applications for FNS, 210,218 timely statewide during that almost six-month period of time. We come out to 94.6%. Two things about that. Number one is the month of January and February, when we're at 90 and 92%, we actually were using what we call the old methodology, where we were adding 2 mailing days for every application, assuming that nobody had an EBT card already, which when we were able through NCFAS to delineate those who do already have an EBT card, I think it was probably half or more, then we were able to add 1 day instead of 2. The benefits would be the next day. And certainly that had a significant impact on our timeliness. As a matter of fact, I think we did reports for both ways for about a month and determined that 1.5 to 2% increase resulted from using what we call the correct methodology. So if we were to have used the new methodology for January and February, those 90 and 92 percentile ratings for those 2 months would have probably been more like 92 and 94. The long and short is we believe that we have, through weekly timeliness reports, achieved the required 95% for this six-month period. Following that up, though, would be our QC data. And for the period of, well, actually January, there were 15 applications reviewed, and there were 15 timely. We were 100%. I think we're going to have a couple untimely, the February report when it comes out. But, you know, it looks like we can about say that we've achieved this. Going forward, we're going to continue to monitor this. We're going to continue to do these reports. USDA will, I'm sure, require these, I think, based on our guidance for the next 6 months. But we believe that we, at the state level and you all at the county level, probably will want to receive these weekly reports to see how you're doing on an ongoing basis. And unless there's indication otherwise, we're going to continue to do that. A little bit on the quality side, though, again, this is improvement. We're getting better. We were 6.64% federal fiscal year ending 14-15, and we are at 4.75% for the October through January period. CAPER, as noted on the report, we were at 59.21% error rate. Federal fiscal year 14-15, we are at 38.13% through the first 4 months of this fiscal year. Improvement, improvement, improvement by counties. So thank everybody for your work on that. Let me move on a little bit.
Wayne, can I have?
Yes, sure. Yeah.
Just real quick. Just to add what Wayne was saying, to show you guys how we have improved, is that currently North Carolina is ranked 32nd in the nation for our active error rate. And I know that sounds like not a great thing, but when you compare it to we were ranked around 48 about 2 months ago. That is a vast improvement. And then for the CAPERS, North Carolina is currently ranked 48th in the nation. Now, that sounds horrible, but if you recall, for the past year, we have been 53rd in the nation. We've had the worst CAPER error rate in the nation. And through January, we're currently at a 38.12% error rate, ranking us at 48th. And we are the most improved state in the country in regards to our CAPER, and are the second most improved state in the country for our active error. So I just wanted to point that out and say congratulations, and thank you guys for a great job. And I believe that we can continue to improve in those two areas.
Thank you, Dave. One note I want to make is in regard to our active error rate. As you know, we've talked about this through last year a little bit. Our active error rate for 14-15 was 6.64%, I believe it was. Anything above 6%, based on our guidance from USDA, we might be in line for a penalty, which could be a certain dollar amount resulting in a penalty that would have to be paid by the state. Perhaps half of it, the other half would be reinvested in the coming year. Federal fiscal year in manner which would improve our payment accuracy. We've just received a letter from USDA June 24th. It went out to all states that they are holding off on both the bonuses that states would occur. We weren't in running for that. But they're also holding off on applying the penalties until they have completed an analysis of every state's QC process. And they will do that between now and December the 31st, which basically means that we will not know for sure if we have a penalty for 2014-15 on payment accuracy or what it is or how it would be applied until sometime after the 1st of 2017, after December 2016. Part of this is prompted by certain states had contracted, as I understand it, with a consultant to help them in their QC process, which resulted in improved timeliness And I think USDA is questioning the validity of maybe some states' reports. I will assert to you, I think with 100% accuracy, that North Carolina is not under any scrutiny for how we do our QC. I think we've got a great team, and I think they're calling it like it is, and nothing's been indicated that we are, you know, kind of under the looking glass, but they are going to look at all 100. So we won't know any more about that until probably early 2017. Is there a question?
There is a question that came through. What state is number one, and what in the world are they doing to be there?
I did not bring
I've got it. I've got it here. Wait a minute. Let me tell you.
I think it's Florida.
Montana is, well, yeah, on the and this is active error rate. Florida is 0.42. Which is pretty doggone good. You almost wonder some of these states, how'd they get that good?
I will add to what Wayne just said. Florida is on the, and I hope nobody's here from Florida or listening, but Florida is one of those states that has been highly scrutinized with their rates, that there are some questioning going on with the state of Florida regarding the validity of their data. So that's all I'll say about Florida. But you know, Florida consistently ranks around the top in the nation.
So, in essence, I think USDA is stepping back and going to do a little analysis of states. How are we all playing the game by the same rules, and are we all on the same playing field? I don't have a problem with that at all. I think we do it all. Okay. Moving on. So, no other questions. One of the things we will be doing, I think, is continuing to focus on the QC part of it, the payment accuracy, because that's going to be very important. I think that's all I have on FNS. So, again, the big part of our program today, I think, as far as presentations, is going to be on regarding the state budget. And we divided this up into our respective divisions, and I'll begin with one thing I want to note, that funding authorizations coming out from our respective budget offices will probably take place over the next 30 days or so. I would say by the 1st of August, funding authorizations should be out some earlier than others. As far as the Division of Social Services, I think if you look at the money report and the special provisions, you will see that we have a lot on the menu, so to speak, a lot in terms of resources provided, but an awful lot in the way of work to do for the coming year. So let me kind of highlight a few of those things for the Division of Social Services, and then we'll move on and take questions as we go through, I think. First of all, adoption assistance. You'll note that there was a $1 million recurring reduction state funds. That's based on the trend line, and we've been underspending in that area, although we are starting to see a leveling. The trend line had been downward. We're starting to see a leveling. We would anticipate actually seeing somewhat of an upward trend line adoptions assistance subsequent to the rise in foster care. We have not seen that yet. We're going to be looking very closely at this, and certainly I would encourage every county to look very closely at your numbers. I've seen some of the reports coming back to me from our practice reviews and from others that note counties seeing an uptick in the number of children that are eligible for adoption. So this will be, I think, the number one area on our list for budget for 2017-19. And we may actually want to get some input and data from counties on a selected basis of what you're seeing, because I would be very surprised if we don't see an uptick over the next year or two. County Child Welfare Services Oversight and Accountability. The Child Welfare section of our department division, I think in the budget, received something like 21 new positions across different areas, which I'll break down a little bit. I'd like to note, however, that we've calculated our numbers here in child welfare, and from about 2008 to about 2013, that's about how many positions, or maybe actually not quite as many positions, as we lost in child welfare. So, you know, want to put this in the context that it's not that we've you know, over time increase positions here. It's like we've kind of back to the future in some sense, but with positions that are absolutely needed, and this comes from everything we know from the CFSR to the statewide study to feedback from counties, feedback from the association, and what we can obviously know ourselves. And I would note that we also got a lot more work that comes along with those positions, particularly with the program improvement plan and other things that we need to be doing. Breaking that down a little bit, seven positions are in the area of assuring a competent and well-trained county-based child welfare workforce. And that is, as I said, evident in our practice reviews. Four positions are to provide technical assistance to counties in terms of implementation of the performance development plans and improvement there. Three of these, I think, will be CPRs and one administrative assistant. We're looking in the area of statewide recruitment plan for foster parents, working to improve that licensing process that we're a little behind on. So there's actually four positions there that will help with that. Also included there is working with both our public and private agencies, county DSSs and private agencies, in terms of the accuracy of the applications themselves. So a little bit of training, I think, in the process would help expedite the process being licensed. CFSR, Child and Family Services Review Program Improvement Plan. We have three positions. Human Service Planner Evaluators, which would be working particularly with the Program Improvement Plan over the next 2 to 3 years, and then would continue to work in our CQI effort. As you know, one of our, I think, priorities is to take the REAP, Reaching for Excellence, Accountability, and Practice to scale on a statewide basis. So I think there'll be other work that would be projected to happen there. Moving on. An area of a lot of money, $8,372,972, which would be for expanding in-home, including expanding in-home services to assure safety of children and families, keeping them together. The ideas there include expanding in intensive family preservation and triple P parenting and those sorts of things. The chief concern is this is non-recurring funding. And our challenge is going to be, we'll see a lot of money. There's a lot of money in here that's non-recurring funding. And the challenge here is how we can most effectively utilize those resources to enhance services without knowing for certain if funding will be allocated in the next biennium. So I'm sure we'll be working a lot with counties on that one. And finally, three positions to add to our team doing child fatality reviews. Very important. I think it was so obvious to us. We were making a presentation to the Social Services Commission, I think it was about a year ago, and we were talking about some of the findings from child fatality reviews, some of the recommendations, and we had just sort of a litany of items. And I think one of the members said, well, have you taken all of these and put them together and mapped out, so to speak, progress on them and where we are? No. There's a great opportunity, I think, here to actually work with counties to ensure that recommendations are implemented, but to also take those recommendations on a statewide basis and ensure that progress is being made. So we feel like these are very important, and also we are very behind. There's a backlog to do this. So we want to do it in what I'll call a timely basis. That doesn't mean next week. That may mean 6 months, 3-6 months, somewhere in there. It doesn't mean 2 years later. I think based on circumstances, we want to be able to do it when they need to be done. And another item that's in there in child welfare, I'll keep going, a statewide strategic plan. As everyone knows, the PCG completed the statewide study evaluation of Child Protective Services and made that recommendation to the General Assembly. So the General Assembly has given it right back to us and said, okie doke, take that, those findings, and now create a strategic plan to address all of those areas, including county performance, caseload sizes, administrative structure, adequacy of funding and funding streams, social work turnover, worker turnover, monitoring and oversight. And it also requires that we address measures of ensuring that Native American children in North Carolina are served in a culturally appropriate manner, including placements for both foster care and adoption. So that strategic plan is due December 1 to the Joint Legislative Oversight Committee on Health and Human Services. And it specifically states it's for consideration in the 2017 long session, which I might add begins in January, which I might add begins in less than 6 months. So, you know, we're already working on the next year's budget. So I think, again, we've already engaged with a potential organization with a national reputation in child welfare and a presence in North Carolina to actually help us with this strategic planning process. We will engage the Directors Association. We've reached out to leadership already. We will absolutely engage the Directors Association in this strategic planning process from the very start and all the way through, as we will with a lot of the other things that I've mentioned. And I'm sure Kevin will be talking a whole lot more about that and you know, with the Directors Association, with the Children's Services Committee going forward. A few other things that are in the budget in our division. One is child welfare, Native American services, non-recurring $60,000 for a grant program to assist in foster parent recruitment. Completion of the child welfare component of NC FAST. It's noted that is the intent of the legislature that NC FAST will be operational by December 31, 2017 in the area of child welfare in North Carolina. And to that end, our division is tasked with providing quarterly reports on the status of the implementation, planning and implementation for that, with our first report being due October 1, 2016. And so we'll be doing that. Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians assumes responsibility for other programs, changes the date for FNS and Medicaid from October 1, 2016 to April 1, 2017. And we're on target at this point for that to happen. FNS outreach for Medicare, Medicaid, dual eligible population. 600,000 non-recurring, with an assumption that there might be federal reimbursement to go along with that. We will be probably required to do a request for proposals on a contract with, I think it states, a firm with a experience and doing outreach to try to identify dual eligibles, Medicare, Medicaid recipients, 65 and older, and if they are not signed up for food nutrition, to help them apply for, become eligible for if they are, and receive those food nutrition services benefits. This is non-recurring funds. My understanding is to test it out, see how it works. It may also be considered ongoing in the long session. And I think there's a report due to the governor and Joint Legislative Oversight Committee by February that we're on that one, too. NC TANF state plan for the period of October 1, 16 through September 30, 2019 was approved by the General Assembly. Our electing counties are Beaufort, Caldwell, Catawba, Lenoir, Lincoln, Macon, and Wilson, seven of them. Eckerd Kids in Caring for Children Angels Watch Program appropriates $1.1 million non-recurring to take a program, which I think is principally in Buncombe County, providing foster care to children 0 to 6 who may have a sibling up to age 10, not in DSS custody, but in a crisis. It's sort of a crisis option, quote-unquote, foster care that would hopefully help alleviate the crisis, as I understand it, and with the intent of preventing children from coming into the child welfare system through foster care at DSS. So this would help to expand that rate to other counties and other children. We've got final reporting to do to the legislature about that one as well. I think Betty Dumas Beasley from Vision Medical Assistance will talk about legislation, special provisions that speak to Medicaid timeliness requirements. There are four positions included for human services planner evaluators within our performance management section, and those will be working very closely with the Division of Medical Assistance and working very closely with NCFAST and Division of Information Technology around the client services data warehouse. I have heard in many reports that I've seen come across my desk that counties need training on the client services data warehouse, and it's coming because these four positions are set up to help put together data and reports and to help counties and really instruct you all on how to use them. So it's connected to Medicaid in the sense of having to create those kinds of reports in the Medicaid program so that you can achieve the performance that's required. Supportive employment opportunities, $300,000 non-recurring for Marketing Association for Rehabilitation Centers, MARC, to create new job opportunities for chronically unemployed people. It's landed in our division budget, and that's all I know about it. And we will be working with the legislature to find out what we will be doing with this and who we will be targeting. But my assumption would be we're perhaps talking about the workforce population in that area. A few other changes. There's funding directed to Boys and Girls Clubs and some other agencies. And then finally, as far as the state budget is concerned, the last area I'm going to postpone and have a discussion about this with Suzanne Merrill, Division of Aging and Adult Services, and there's something called Temporary Assistance for Facilities that Serve Special Assistance Recipients. And this will be a biggie, and it's one that our Division of Aging and Adult Services and our division will sort of share. It's kind of in our division because of budget. State County Special Assistance lies in the DSS budget, but it's certainly the area that impacts the Division of Aging and Adult Services. So we'll have that conversation shortly. And the only other thing I wanted to comment on, there are a few things, and I'll be done here in a minute. I said there's a lot in the Division of Social Services. I wasn't making that up. Division of Social Services, TANF block grants. I think the highlights there, we did reduce TANF cash by $3 million. But Workforce County block grants to counties, counties picked up $2,020,129 more in the second year of the biennium than was originally projected. So that's a $2 million gain that county DSS was receiving in your county block grants above what would have been there had those adjustments not been made. In addition, there's Child Welfare Initiatives, $1.4 million, enhancing the skills of social workers, enhancing the provision of services to families. We'll be looking at that in terms of how that will be allocated and how it will be used. Transfer to SSBG for county DSS, slight increase in that, very slight increase in the county's funding in SSBG, not very much, from what it would have been the second year of the biennium. Two items are in there that we will be working out details on in TANF contingency. One is $603,580. For county child welfare improvement resources. Now, TANF dollars are earmarked and must be used serving families with children less than 200% of the federal poverty level. But we did have that in there with some available funds this year to help counties out. One of the things we want to do, maybe indirectly, is to support counties' efforts towards participating in the training activities that we're going to be providing, particularly in child welfare. The other is for our administrative DSS child welfare program, $400,000. And again, that's to support our efforts around training and support to not only for staff training, pre-service training, ongoing training, but also supervisor training and supervisor academy that we're working on. And finally, just a couple things. I think there's maybe a question or two. The social services block grant. There's $737,067 child welfare training for counties looking at mobile training opportunities that will be provided there. Question?
Just a question, and I don't know if you can answer it or not, but how much state and federal dollars go to the Boys and Girls Clubs? Does anybody know that one?
Well, it would be state dollars. Don't think there's any TANF or SSPG that is, I'm not sure about that. That's a figure we can come up with. There's a strong support in the legislature for Boys and Girls Clubs. We do know that from many years going forward. Any other questions about DSS?
No.
Okay. We're going to move on. And next up, we're going to hear from the Division of Child Development and Early Education, Janice Fain.
Can I introduce Jose? While I'm giving my report?
Sure.
I don't know if we can't see him, maybe, but I'll introduce him. Good morning. I did want to mention that we have a new CCDF subsidy budget officer, Jose Mirza, and he's with us in the room today. You will recall that John Winstead retired, and Sharon Marsalis and myself have been splitting those duties for the past year, and we are so excited that Jose is on board now with us. He has been working with our division for quite a while and in another capacity in our budget office, and we're very fortunate that he has moved over to this position. So I know you'll enjoy working with Jose. I want to also express appreciation and a big thank you to the counties for a successful year for state fiscal year 15-16. I know it was a challenging year in some respects because counties received allocations that were very different from what were projected last year based on some changes in the allocation formula. And thank you so much for being willing to move money around. We had three successful reversions and reallocations last year, and to my knowledge, no terminations of services, and if there were, children were able to be reinstated to services, but that was because the other counties were willing to help out across county lines, and thank you very much. And also a thank you to our LBLs, the local business liaisons, who worked very hard with counties in helping to manage allocations last year. I want to also thank counties for a great closeout this year for 15-16. It went very smoothly. We ended up the year at 97% spending, so it was very successful. I want to talk a little bit about next year's budget for 16-17, and we'll describe this more in detail in the funding allocation letter that we prepare when we do send out the final allocations for you. Overall, we were very happy with the budget, how it looked for DCDEE and for the subsidy program for 16-17. We ended up with about $8.4 million more available for subsidy services in state fiscal year 16-17 than was available in 15-16. This was due to some increases for market rates. There was an additional $3.4 million set aside for market rate increases in Tier 1 and 2 counties for 16-17, and this is for ages 3 to 5. And you'll recall that last year the General Assembly set aside funds for increases in these counties for infant-toddler market rates. So this is a continuation to build on that effort. There was also a $1.3 million increase in state funds just for overall subsidy, so it was not earmarked for market rates. We had about $3 million more in carry forward from CCDF, so that was our major federal source of funding for the subsidy program. And then we had $3 million more in state dollars that annualized the infant-toddler market rate increases from last year. You'll recall that those went into effect in January, so there was $3 million more in the budget this year to annualize those increases. These increases, that adds up to more than the 8.4 that I told you about, but those increases were offset by a couple of decreases in the subsidy budget due to some swapping of TANF for state funds. So So we did see a bigger decrease, a larger decrease in state funds. But overall, when you compare the increases to decreases, we ended up with a net of about $8.4 million more available. We are working on the allocations for your non-Smart Start funds. The, as you recall, there is a new way that the funds are allocated. Counties receive a base amount, and that base amount is equal to their prior year expenditures. And then counties are eligible for additional funds above that amount based on their rate of spending from the previous year. So when we have been looking at preliminary allocations, we've been running some models of the allocation formula with the increased dollar amounts. We think there's, after we give everybody their base amount of what they spent in 15-16, it looks like there'll be approximately $13 million to distribute, to allocate to counties that spent over 95% or over per the new allocation formula. And then there'll be a little over $9 million to allocate for market rate increases. That takes into account the $6 million that annualizes the infant toddler rates, and then the new $3.4 million for the 3 to 5 year old market rates in those tier one and two counties. So we will be finalizing these allocations soon. I think we have a meeting on Wayne's and Pam's calendars this week to go over some preliminary models of how this looks. And we will be getting those out to you just as soon as we can. We know that you need that information. There were some other legislation that impacted our subsidy program this year. One was a special provision to study market rates. This is a report that's due back to the General Assembly by March of 2017. We are going to, we are directed to study the methodology for establishing market rates, including some cost models. This is a new factor for us. Currently, market rates are based on a survey that we do of providers on what they are charging parents. But the special provision asks us to consider a cost factor this time. And this is also supported by the recent reauthorization of our major federal funder, the CCDF block grant, where we are, states are now allowed to look at some alternative rate setting methodologies that will include some cost factors. So we are looking forward to digging into examining what this might mean for market rates. Of course, we talked about market rate increase, that some funding was set aside for 3 to 5 year old rate increases at 3 to 5 star level in tier one and tier two counties. Those will become effective October 1. In other areas of DCD's budget not tied to subsidy, there was a little more than $1.3 million added to our NC Pre-K program, and that's a recurring addition. We'll be getting some information out to our pre-K contractors soon about that additional fund. We had some swaps in our pre-K program. TANF always seems to end up in NC Pre-K swapping out, and that happened again in this year. Another budget item, I guess this does impact subsidy. The budget did allow us to establish some new federal positions in our division, including 4 positions in our subsidy program to help us in efforts around fraud prevention and detection. So we are looking forward to setting up those positions. And finally, there were some special provisions that impacted our agency that require us to do some studies, some additional studies, not only the one about market rate methodology that I mentioned before, but there are also some studies around looking at how pre-K costs and rates, how pre-K rates are established, and then the costs to provide the pre-K services. There's also a study required on early childhood collaboration across agencies that serve the early childhood population, and a study around the transition of children in our pre-K program and our subsidy program into kindergarten. So these, if these sound familiar, they do come from recommendations that were made from a joint legislative oversight study committee that was done this past year through the HHS committee process. So those recommendations did find their way into some special provisions this year. But that is it for DCD, and I'll be glad to answer any questions.
No questions.
Janice, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to move on to the Division of Medical Assistance. Betty Dumas Beasley is here with us today.
Good morning, everyone. Oh, Medicaid budget. I'm not going to go into all the details that Wayne did, because Medicaid is huge. But I did want to talk about the pieces that affected the counties. As Wayne mentioned earlier, the Medicaid eligibility determination timeliness requirements and penalties for counties not meeting those requirements. PED, the Program Evaluation Division, had did an audit during 2014-2015, and there were some issues based on timeliness that was cited with the counties. Well, they have now, it has now been approved that orders the state auditors to do a performance audit for county DSS administration on the Medicaid program and the timeliness of enrollment and applications determinations. The budget also inserts statutory language that would monitor the timeliness of the county DSS Medicaid eligibility determinations and provides a mechanism for temporary state DSS takeover of county agencies in the event significant delays in approving Medicaid applications. DMA is currently working with NCFAS to create this timeliness report. We encourage counties to start looking at their untimely reports. NCFAS sends out reports daily, and you will notice that there are around 3,300 untimely applications that's pending either from the healthcare.gov or from MAGIS or your traditional applications. We encourage you to begin reviewing those applications, evaluating to determine what the next steps are so that North Carolina will not have any untimely pending applications. ACA policy changes have been streamlined. MAGIS and healthcare.gov, very few of them should be untimely. Please make sure you document on your traditional in case it could be a DDS applications, but I keep in contact with DDS monthly, and they have no untimelies that they're working on from the time they receive the DDS application. So it all depends on when the county submits that application to DDS. So again, we hope to share with you by August 1st, the new report card on timeliness. Some other areas that the budget approved was the remove the sunset on the Medicaid eligibility COLA disregard. You might have not known that there was a sunset provision. This means if a person's income increases over the threshold of Medicaid eligibility because of the cost of living adjustment and retirement or Social Security, they would lose their Medicaid benefits. Previously, this COLA disregard was due to sunset in December 31st, 2017. So it will not sunset, so we will continue each year to be able to disregard that income. They've approved to expand support for patients with Alzheimer's disease and families with changing the requirements in our North Carolina Community Alternative Program for Disabled Adults waiver to increase to a maximum of 320 slots. These slots are going to be targeted for Alzheimer's patients that are in the Medicaid program. Our clinical policy is we'll be working with the counties. None of your processes will change at this time. They will be getting out a letter to the counties. We also received approval for 250 additional slots for our 1915C innovation waivers, which allows people with intellectual and developmental disabilities who would otherwise be in an institution will now be able to remain in the community with support. And that's effective January 2017. We received additional funding for our Division of Health Benefits. Those additional fundings will be used to train some of the existing staff and the skills that they will need once we transfer over to the Division of Health Benefits. We are looking at specialties in analytics, along with clinical policies with managed care and capitations, and also with our systems, how we will start tracking and monitoring health insurance. So we're excited about that move. Again, please go on and read, keep up with the Division of Health Benefits as we continue to have quarterly meetings. We post lots of information on our DMA website for providers. Nothing else really on the budget to share with the counties. We wanted to still reiterate about the NEMT. That project is moving forward. The provider enrollment, the county pilots, the vendors, the uploading process, everything is going in order. PCG has begun conducting the required site visits. However, we've had to put that on hold due to some of the providers not understanding the training. So we're going to provide additional trainings and handouts and education for the providers. There will be a Dear County Director letter that will be sent out to the counties next week or so to inform providers about the site visits and what is expected. Provider training for enrollment, though, has been completed. Every provider has been trained. The next step is training on how to enter a professional claim into NCFAS in order for payment to be received. We've not scheduled that training yet, but we're working on it. We're also working on the testing, so when the provider submits the claims, we want to ensure that they receive the correct payment. There's going to be additional training for the counties on how to upload your payment authorization September 1st, 2016, and then all the other counties will follow after that January 2017. I believe all the counties already know who the pilot counties are. I'll just remind you, Alamance, Cumberland, Catawba, Franklin, Roanne, and Lincoln has received the PA file layout, which is a spreadsheet required for uploading their information into NCTRAX. This will be how the vendor will determine how much they get paid, so when they go in to file their claim, it'll already be on the inside of the NCTRAX claims, and then we'll validate and pay that bill. There'll be additional meetings held with CSRA, which is our physical agent for NCTRAX, and DMA. We are providing provisioning to your NEMT staff in order to be able to go into NCTRAX and be able to see the PA information that they have uploaded. Also, we are about done with the training for your other county Medicaid staff to have access into NCTRAX in order to help them see the eligibility when it moves over from FAST to TRAX, and they'll be able to answer some of the providers' questions that have been calling. We hope to have that up and running, I believe, sometime in August. VMA has updated the date of birth report. It is critical, directors, it is critical that that date of birth report be completed by the end of July 2016. We have received numerous calls from providers providing services to children and not receiving payment because the date of birth is wrong. And if the date of birth is wrong, a child may not be covered for certain services, but yet that provider has provided that service because it looks like that child is eligible based on the date of birth that came across that the caseworker entered in fast, and it went over overnight the tracks. And so that's what the provider sees as the age of the child. We have OST that have reached out to counties, and we have saw a decrease in just a few weeks. So we know that you are putting emphasis on that, but we are recommending that that be completed by the end of July. We are putting out two additional pieces of policies where we're updating enumeration and residency. You will see those changes. We'll be posting that in the IEM manual by next week. Or it may be in there this week because Robert Cox is pretty fast. So we want to thank Robert for his diligent job in posting that information. And the last thing we want to share is Social Security number deletion authorization. Prior, the county had access to be able to delete a Social Security number when they inadvertently assigned an CNDS ID number. The state took that role back as we were transitioning into NCFAS. Now we're going to give the counties back that role, but it will be given to a few supervisors in each county. They will be able to remove that Social Security number and then allow the county worker to key in the correct information. A Dear County Director letter is going out in the next week. It is from DSS and DMA. Training will be provided. There'll be a link showing you where the training is. It will be mandatory that all county Medicaid and food stamp workers take this training before access is granted. NCFAS is working on providing a role to the supervisors and the counties to have that ability. That's all the updates from DMA at this time. Any questions anyone has?
There is one observation that we've received. We have noticed on the application log that the administrative applications are showing up late, causing our county to look like we have had more late applications than we actually do. We are keying more administrative applications than normal due to the change from PLA to LTC. Previous application log prior to NCF did not list the administrative applications.
Okay. I can check with NCFAS to determine what is the process, and then I'll send an email up to Andy, and we can respond out to the counties. Thanks for sharing that.
The other observation is, thank you, Betty. That's awesome news.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you, Betty. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, moving on to our Division of Aging and Adult Services, Suzanne Merrill.
Okay, good morning. I'm going to start with the legislative changes that were actually in our division's budget, and then I'll come back to what Wayne mentioned in terms of the temporary assistance payments for special assistance recipients, and Wayne and I'll talk about that together. But within our budget, we had two items. We had an increase of $550,000. It's recurring funding to our Project CARE program. I think many of you are familiar with that. That's the project that supports family caregivers of individuals with Alzheimer's and other dementias. So what this funding will do will allow us to expand our consultants, our project care consultants that are based regionally across the state. We have three family caregiver consultants now, and this will allow us to increase from three to six. So we'll have six individuals working with families across all of the state. And then the balance of the new funding will allow us to do respite vouchers for families to give them a couple of vouchers on an annual basis so that obviously they can have the benefit of those respite services. And actually, I don't know that anybody would remember this necessarily, but we had the funding for the respite vouchers several years ago, and when we got into tighter economic times, we lost that state funding. So this actually restores that funding for those respite vouchers. So we'll be working to hire those three additional family consultants to work with families, and then setting up our system to get those vouchers out for respite. The other item specifically in our budget is a recurring allocation of $200,000, and that is for two new positions at our division. And what the positions will do, the impetus for this came out of our new state Alzheimer's plan. In that plan, there was a lot of recommendations around creating a system of access and information and services for long-term services and supports, and it's called No Wrong Door. And obviously, it's what it suggests, that where you access long-term services and supports, there's no wrong door in terms of those access points. So it's something that we started under a federal grant in collaboration with the Division of Medical Assistance, and it found its way into the state Alzheimer's plan. So the positions will work to expand that No Wrong Door initiative on a statewide basis. We're working right now with the 211 system under United Way to develop what's called the front door, which is information and referral. And so this will give us the opportunity to move beyond just that information and referral activity into a more full-blown access system statewide. The other items that these two positions are to address will be to work with the 211 system to develop a component specifically related to information and referral and access for families and individuals with Alzheimer's disease and related dementias. And then the third area that the two positions are to work on are to continue implementation of the state Alzheimer's plan. There are 33 recommendations in that plan, and a large number of them involve our division and working with other stakeholders. So it's an effort to assure ongoing implementation of the state Alzheimer's plan. So that's in our budget. And then, as I think everybody knows, the State County Special Assistance Program, the funding is actually in the Division of Social Services budget. And so State DSS has found itself with a new responsibility tied to a program they don't manage, but you have it in your funding, in your budget. And so what this action by the General Assembly does is to set up a temporary assistance payments for individuals who are SA recipients, and it appropriates $3.7 million. These are non-recurring dollars for these temporary assistance payments. They're to be matched at the county level with another $3.7 million to create a total budget of $7.5 million. So it's the funding follows the same logic as our regular SA program, but this is completely separate from the SA, regular SA budget. It is temporary assistance that begins in October of this year and expires in June 30th of 2017. And it's the funding is to the mechanism that, to get the funding out, it will go directly to providers rather than going to the beneficiaries. As you well know, the current SA program, the beneficiaries receive the payment, and in this temporary assistance, it's going directly to the adult care home providers. So what has to be established is a mechanism to be able to pay a provider network that is involved with 21,000 SA recipients, an average of 21,000 SA recipients on a monthly basis. So we have to create a mechanism that will reimburse those providers $34 per month per SA recipient between October 1 and June 30th, or until that money runs out. If the money is exhausted prior to June 30th, then that would be the end of the temporary assistance payment. So there was no administrative funding allocated, so it leaves it to the Division of Social Services to figure out how to get what mechanism to establish to get those reimbursements to those providers. It's no small task. We have about 1,300 adult and family care home providers. There are several thousand group home providers, mental health and IDD group home providers that where SA recipients reside. We have SA recipients in combination nursing home facilities. So we are talking about a large number of SA recipients and a large number of providers that we have to create a mechanism to get these individuals paid on a monthly basis. So it is something that we're going to be working on with the Division of Social Services.
Oh, it's good to have friends. Absolutely. This is where we're glad that we are partners between our divisions.
Yeah.
Suzanne, and a little bit of, I guess, maybe why is this being done? The House budget included an SA rate increase. It was $34 a month. And obviously 50% county, 50% state. But it also means if we increase the SA rate, as I understand it, then we raise that level, and it also would increase the number of individuals eligible for Medicaid. Medicaid flows along with it. And if you go back and look at the original House budget, in addition to the $3.75 million in state money for SA increase, it included $4.1 million in recurring state dollars for the Medicaid increase, the Medicaid services part of it. So really, what they're trying to do here, I guess, to use a word from years past, is delink payments for SA recipients to adult care homes and others from Medicaid. So we can just do the one without increasing the other. And certainly that's, I understand where they're coming from. The challenge, of course, obviously is, and I know Angie Taylor with NCPAS and I, we've had a conversation. I know that Angela's working on for their team to see what options there might be to do these payments, to create a separate payment. So the SA payment may be $1,000 in a month, and that's earmarked. And then the temporary assistance payment for the individual for the facility, I guess, would be $34 a month. So I don't see any way feasible that this can be done for zero. So, but what that's going to be and what the impact of that's going to be, I guess we don't know yet. It is delineated clearly in the legislation in special provisions that counties will provide 50%. So that's when we talk about 3.75 million count, I mean state, then we're basically looking at 3.75 million in county dollars. The other thing that's in there is a special provision is on the state level a reduction of $1 million recurring from SA, the state portion of SA. Now that would be comparable at the county level too, but I would caution counties in looking at your SA payments in looking at both your SA budget as well as the impact of this, you've got to look at your own individual county circumstances. Because when we're looking at the state budget, we're looking at all 100 counties, and the counties may be moving up or moving down or steady. It's kind of like foster children. At foster care and adoption, you really have to look at your own county circumstances and look at your own trend lines in terms of making the projections. The other thing I think is we're required to submit a plan by April 1, 2017 on a long-term solution to assure adequate facility reimbursement without increasing Medicaid eligibility limit. So that will be a challenge.
Just to further comment on what Wayne is saying, the concern really was with the Senate in terms of expanding the Medicaid budget. I think many of you, those of you who do SA eligibility, know that if you're eligible for SA, you're automatically eligible for Medicaid. And so any rate increase that increases the eligibility limit for SA, the income threshold, then that many more people would qualify for SA, and so they're automatically eligible for Medicaid. And we, at the request of legislative staff, we worked with DMA to calculate what that increase would be with a $34 a regular rate increase, and it came up to the 4.1 million, and that was a sticking point for the Senate. And so this was the compromise between the House and the Senate. The thinking was that the industry needed a rate increase, and this was the way to do it on a temporary basis to get the funding to the providers and not run afoul of any federal legislation that guides SSI or an optional state supplement program, which SA is under the Social Security Administration. So this was a way to accomplish that in the short run. And then and Wayne is incorrect in terms of the study that's required. That's exactly the point here, is to be able to de-link that automatic Medicaid eligibility from SA. There, the SA group is a coverage group under the state Medicaid plan, and that's the way it's established now. It would take approval from CMS to do a state plan amendment to do that decoupling. I don't know that anybody necessarily remembers this, but several years ago, the General Assembly was interested in this same idea of decoupling SA from Medicaid and directed our division to do a study, and we did do a study, and there were issues then with disenfranchising about 5,200 people who would no longer qualify for Medicaid if we decoupled the SA from Medicaid and used the regular age, blind, and disabled Medicaid eligibility for people in residential settings. What you know, the quick answer is for those of you who are familiar with the SA in-home program, you know, Medicaid is not coupled with the SA in-home program. Those individuals must qualify for Medicaid at the age, blind, and disabled 100% of the federal poverty level, so they qualify for Medicaid first, and if they do and have a need for an SA payment, then they qualify for the SA in-home payment. So it would be the same logic on the residential side, that you'd qualify for Medicaid separately and then qualify for SA in a residential setting based on need. So the current income threshold for SA in the residential setting is above 100% of the federal poverty level, so you would end up, if you decoupled them right now, you would end up disenfranchising a fairly large number of people, and that was a concern to CMS several years ago and would certainly be a concern to them now. And there's some other concerns that the Social Security Administration has about decoupling. I won't go into all that, but needless to say, when we did the study a couple of years ago, we hit roadblocks with both federal agencies, and I don't know that anything has changed, but we will do this study as directed and see where it takes us this go around. So a couple of other things. related to our legislative highlights. I don't know that this is widely known, but 2 years ago, the lead responsibility for adult care home cost reporting was transitioned to our division. It used to be the sole responsibility of the DHHS Controller's Office, and the thinking in the department was because we manage the SA program for eligibility that we ought to manage rate setting as well. But we do that in conjunction clearly with the Controller's Office, since we don't have the kind of staff in the Division of Aging and Adult Services. We don't have CPAs who we don't, as a division, don't do rate setting. We're a social work agency. But anyway, so we work closely with the Controller's Office, but there are some changes in the adult care home cost reporting statute that were made in this legislative session. Now cost reports are done every two, audited cost reports are done every 2 years rather than an annual cost reporting, and we are directed to use the data from the cost reports to determine any adjustments in the SA rates. That has always been the thinking in the cost reporting statute, but it's made very clear that that's the intent. The other thing that was changed in the cost reporting is there was a fairly detailed timeline for when the various facilities that have to report, the timeline that they were to report on an annual basis, and all of that has been eliminated, and we are now directed to establish reporting deadlines for the various facility types that have to do the cost report. So we'll be working with the Controller's Office and industry representatives to determine what is an appropriate timeline for the adult and family care homes, the group homes, and the combination nursing homes, all of which do serve SA recipients. So not that that has really a bearing on county DSSs, but it is, I think, part of this whole thinking about decoupling SA from Medicaid and being able to do SA rate increases on some sort of schedule basis and not have to be concerned about the impact on the Medicaid budget. Two other things quickly are all of the transfers that are in the SSBG plan, that the transfers to the Home and Community Care Block Grant, the State In-Home Fund, the State Adult Daycare Fund, the Guardianship Corporations, APS Guardianship, those specific carve-outs, those are all pretty much essentially remaining the same as they were from the biennial budget, so no real changes there in those SSBG transfers. And then finally, House Bill 817 that is an act to enacts Uniform Adult Guardianship and Protective Proceedings Jurisdiction Act. That is something that out of the last session of the General Assembly that we have been supportive of. AARP, it makes for easier transition across state lines when guardianship proceedings are involved. It's good for families and good for guardians when there's a need to cross state lines. But that bill has been ratified by both houses, and it is on the governor's desk for signature, and we don't anticipate any problems there. So once the governor signs that bill, we'll get information out about it. But mostly it will impact clerks of Superior Court and attorneys and guardians when there's a need to cross state lines. So that's what we have for budget highlights, and then a little later on Joyce Massey Smith is going to come up and do some other program updates. So.
And any questions?
No questions.
I guess the only thing I would add would be, if you're a county DSS director and your budget was completed, the county budget was completed prior to the state budget, which includes the $3.75 million countywide, I reckon, for the coming year. You probably do not have this expansion item really in your budget. So my recommendation on that is that you pull out the special provisions and make a copy of the provision relative to temporary assistance for adult care homes for SA recipients, and obviously have that conversation with your county manager, your board, social services, or board of county commissioners, or human services board as appropriate, and with the caveat of don't shoot messenger. Because you're in a position of implementing at the county DSS level what is a mandate from the General Assembly.
Right.
That's basically what it is.
Yeah, and I've been thinking, you know, a quick way to calculate that is to look at your current SA caseload, times $34 per month.
Take half of that.
October to June would be the maximum impact on a DSS budget.
Yeah, and I think the caveat it would be it says until the money runs out or June 30th. I don't know that we have a. I guess we estimated 3.75 million based on the caseload and growth or
that was the when the House was doing their budget, they wanted a projection in terms of what it would take to do the $34 rate increase, and so that was our best projection. And one thing, let me mention, this does not impact your SA in-home recipients. It is just your SA recipients in residential settings, both your special care units and basic SA. So, and when we did the calculations for a $34 rate increase, we included the SA in-home population. So there are about 3,500 SA in-home recipients, and so the projection is probably a little high in terms of 3.7, because we're not including, about 3,500 people who would have gotten that rate increase otherwise if we had done a regular SA rate increase.
So it's likely that the funds will last through June
30th. That is the thinking over with legislative staff, that there would be, with $7.5 million, there would be adequate funding beginning October to have that $34 temporary assistance payment last for those 9 months for all of our SA recipients. Nothing for anybody pending, but these would be current recipients, and there are some details and all of that need to be worked out. So it's not.
Okay, so it's basically 9 months time the number, your monthly number of SA recipients, not in home, just those in adult care homes, replacement, times $17, which would be the 50%. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're right, 17, not 30, but it's a total of 34, but we're putting, the state fund is putting up the other half of that.
Thank you very much. We're pleased to have with us today Dr. Jason Vogler. Dr. Vogler is the interim director of the Division of Mental Health, Developmental Disabilities, and Substance Abuse Services. I think that's the effective July 1, right?
He is
one of your first items of business, probably, in your new position, right?
There have been a lot in the last.
Oh, well, it's been a fast week, right? Okay.
Well, thank you all. I think I'm going to sort of hit some of the high points as well, and I think there are some similar themes in that there's a lot of non-recurring money that came out of the budget bill. The first item is that there are $20 million that are placed in reserves, non-recurring, for the DMHDDSAS to propose to OSBM how we would utilize that money towards the governor's task force on mental health and substance use initiatives. So what that means for us is now, essentially, we're going to have to do what previously had been planned for sustainable services. We're now going to have to do that sort of in a pilot form. Simply because you can't necessarily start services where then the money is going to dry up, because we know then the consumers would end up losing those services. So we're going to be working with a lot of folks very soon to figure out how we're going to pilot some of those services and plans that were in the governor's task force. The next is the community paramedicine pilot program. That had gone out last year in terms of $5,000 small grants. That money at that time was non-recurring. Originally, the final report on the progress of that was to be due December of this year. The legislation changes that so that the final report is due in March, but that was not did not receive any additional funding. So once the plan is once we are able to get the data back from the pilot and evaluate that, the idea would be looking at that into the future to see if there's a way that that could be done on a fee-for-service basis. But effectively, by the end of the year, those pilots will essentially be completed. There, some large items did make it in that were originally part of the governor's task force recommendations. One is the medication-assisted opioid use treatment pilot. That's probably the biggest item that came out. That is a 3-year pilot. It is to take place in the federally qualified health centers, or the FQHCs. And there is $500,000 to be used for those 3 different sites during the next fiscal year. So that money will go out. And there was previously some mention about a specific drug that did not make it into the final. So it will allow for options and opportunities for people to be able to do comparisons as they need to. There is a special provision added so that if there is a Medicaid surplus, if it's less than $30 million, then it would be that amount that gets transferred to the LMEMCOs. If it's more, then it would be no more than $30 million that would be transferred then back to the LMEMCOs to offset the reduction that they had in their single stream funding. And so I do believe we just had, or in the process of having a transfer for this year. So that is essentially the money that was not spent in one set or type of services ends up getting shifted over to offset those, mainly for those people who have not qualified for Medicaid or have not applied for Medicaid. There, $12 million non-recurring was appropriated for the expansion of psychiatric beds or facility-based crisis, and that is into rural areas. And the specific way that that's identified is rural areas that have a sort of a shortage of inpatient beds and the highest demand for those. So, you know, if you only have one bed and you have 500,000 people in that area who need it, you're obviously going to be high on the list versus if you have 500,000 beds and only one person who needs it. So that caveat was somewhat unusual, but I think based on some of the previous things that have been suggested, this really, really helps to make sure that it's not only rural, but in places where there is a high level of need. So that $12 million is there, and there's a report due to the Legislative Oversight Committee on Health and Human Services and the Fiscal Research Division by December of 2017 to show where those beds are and how they've been utilized. Obviously, they want to see that if the money is going to go out and produce coverage of these needs, it actually is doing that. There's an additional $2 million for facility-based crisis for children, and it really is exciting. It's 2 grants. Last year, some people may have been aware there were grants put out for the adult facility-based crisis specifically. This time, the $2 million will go out in 2 different grant awards for a facility-based crisis targeting children and adolescents. The concern there with FBC is always that it takes quite a bit of time to see that come to fruition because you're talking about procuring land, zoning, sometimes building, then all the licensure that is required. And so in the past, what we've learned is that it does take quite a bit of time. So there is a provision in there that allows for us to report on the progress, not necessarily the completion by the end of the biennial. TBI, there were no changes to that. The funding, we actually think there was somewhat of an error in the budget bill last at the beginning of the biennium, where it only specified for a year, and they sort of clarified that the money that was originally appropriated was good throughout the biennium, so it goes through June 2017. The next one, which is sort of large, is the controlled substance reporting system. So this has been in place, but there's been a lot of debate about how what some of the needs were and how to change or improve that system. $600,000 non-recurring was appropriated for upgrades that were immediately needed to this system to get it in line with some of the pharmacy standards. And to help with some of the technical underpinning things that thankfully I don't understand. but I'm sure it's quite complicated to get all of that and to make sure essentially that system is able to accommodate all the different types of prescribers and providers who need to enter information. $375,000 recurring was appropriated for ongoing maintenance of this. That's really encouraging, because traditionally with these technological things, there's not been recurring money and it breaks down and then you can't figure out how to fix them. So this is really important. And then $653,000 roughly in non-recurring money was put in for necessary software upgrades. And I think most of us are familiar with how technology works. The minute you get it, it's 10 years out of date, it seems. So the importance in moving forward here also is that the special provision changes some of the penalty for prescribers who fail to utilize the system. It essentially is adding a layer of accountability for prescribers. And, you know, obviously this has a much broader scope, but a lot of this is really targeting the opioid crisis that I think everyone is familiar with. State, and it's really a national trend everywhere. The next sort of large item is there's a continuation of the roughly $4,500,000 in what we call the three-way contract beds, or it's for the purchase of inpatient psychiatric beds, and it's done in a three-way contract between the LMEMCO, the provider, so the hospital-specific site, and DMH DDSAS. And this continues that same model into the next year. The one change that is now in there is, through a special provision, allows us to use 10% of those funds, if they are unexpended, to go to pay for non-inpatient detox and facility-based crisis. So rather than traditionally what has happened, if those funds go unexpended, they just revert back. This allows us to use those to fund additional services that are still targeting crisis type of services. And then like other folks, there is a study component. For us, it was labeled as a strategic plan for the improvement of behavioral health services. By November 2017, a report is due to the Joint Legislative Oversight Committee on Health and Human Services and Medical Assistance and Health Choice. And in that report, we have to report out on how we will be working as a state to reduce some of the fragmentation and improve the cohesion, the contracts, the service array, et cetera, of individuals in the community. Within DHHS, with the Secretary, Dave Richard, and I have a meeting set up soon to talk about how we're going to prepare and begin planning how we're going to do this strategic plan. In the meantime, both of the joint legislative oversight committees that I mentioned will be establishing a behavioral health services subcommittee that will be meeting jointly across those two joint LOCs, and then they will be monitoring our progress on how we're moving forward. I can say there are some elements of it that are a bit tricky. One of the items in there that particularly is going to be difficult is it mandates that we have a single contract for services with LME, NCOs, and providers, and they're as one can imagine, there are several CMS rules and other issues that are going to make that difficult, I think, to figure out, just because entitlements versus non-entitlements and the rules around how services are designed and created for CMS versus the state service side. So it's going to be a big, big task. That's really, it doesn't sound like as much, but it is quite a bit.
It's a lot.
It's a lot that's in there. And then, you know, mainly it's just continuing a lot of the other priorities, obviously working collaboratively as there continue to be consolidations of LME NCOs.
The common theme there, I think, Jason, is sometimes the General Assembly fails to recognize the limitations and constraints imposed on us by our federal partners, rules and regulations and so forth.
Yeah, there's some direction of block grant spending that it's really hard to condense. Thank you.
All right.
Appreciate your time.
Thank you much. All right. The only other thing I want to mention right quickly, I think, under budget, although it's really not budget, I think at some point in time we'll have more feedback to everybody about legislation that may have been separate outside of the budget. One of those I do want to mention, and I'll go ahead and ask Dave Locklear to come up, we'll talk about food nutrition services, is in the area of House Bill 1047, I think it was, which would have required a connection, a link between the Lottery Commission and NCFAST and the reporting of winnings from the lottery of anyone above $2,250 a month, I think it would have been. And then that would have been, information used in terms of assessing eligibility for food nutrition services. And it also included a study, I think it would ended up being looking at categorical eligibility, and then it also, I think, established some parameters or requirements for disqualification from programs or FNS based on disqualification for other federal programs. It passed the House, it landed in a committee in the Senate, and it that's where it ended. So That will be something we won't be dealing with this year. Right, David?
But probably next year.
Next year, I think it'll be back.
It'll be back.
We'll longer to do it. Okay. All right, David.
So real quickly, I think Wayne's given you the information around the timeliness. I won't rehash that. I'll just briefly mention employment and training and the ABOT update. We are working on a employment and training convening that's going to be scheduled for August. The last week of August, we are hoping to get out information registration packet within the next week or so. Information was included in the social services monthly update that went out, I think, last week regarding that. Simply send hold the date, August the 22nd through the 24th. It will be held in Greensboro, and we'll get information out soon about the convening regarding employment and training. We are working with several counties that are interested in expanded and to begin an employment and training program for the new federal fiscal year, which begins in October. So we're working with several counties that are interested in that. So again, as I've said before, if your county is interested in an employment and training program within the food nutrition services, we strongly encourage you to reach out to us and let us discuss that, because we do have a requirement, a mandate from our federal partners, USDA, to increase our employment and training program across the state. So the ABODs, we did turn on the time clock, if you will, for last Friday, July 1st, for the remainder 77 counties across the state. So as of July 1, we have no county that is under a waiver for the ABOD time limit. So that means every ABOD across the state that is not meeting the 20-hour work requirements or does not have a disability or meet any of the other exemptions are eligible to receive benefits for 3 months out of a 36-month period. I'm not aware of any issues. I'm not hearing of any issues from any county, so we assume everything's working well. I did reach out to the operational support team, Regina Bell and Barbara, earlier the week, and they're not aware of any issues that counties are encountering with the ABODs. We are working on with NC FAST on some reports, specifically for the 23 counties that will show those individuals that have exhausted their 3 free months and are no longer eligible for benefits after they've received their 3 consecutive 3 months. So we're hoping to have those reports available to counties very soon. I know many of you are getting media requests in your areas about how many individuals have we terminated as a result of the new provision. So that information is forthcoming. And that is all I have, Wayne. If you want to move to that other, I'll sit here if there's something.
Yeah. Thank you, David. The next item we want to talk about is Equifax, the work number. And the reason we need to talk about this is that we've got a funding issue. The bottom line, let me give you a little bit of history about Equifax. This is TALKS, the work number. It's the component or division of whatever. And I guess to go back several years, David, in the past, maybe 7 or 8 years, I guess, or more, at one time I think there was no fee for the service. At one time I think counties had to fax the information and get it back in 3 days for something, verification of employment. And, of course, Equifax is one of maybe, we're not sure how many, but a group of companies that contract with employers to provide data on wages, on their employment. They, as we understand it, are probably the biggest game in town in terms of having the most employers, particularly in the southeastern part of the country and, of course, particularly North Carolina. And then I think at some point in time, then there was a fee for the service, and it's pretty much online. And at that point in time, several years ago, a decision was made that the state would pick up the non-federal share. By non-federal share, I mean that the costs for this are cost allocated based upon utilization to Medicaid or to food nutrition services or to Work First and also to child support. And it has been set up that we had one monthly fee amount, irregardless of the number of what we'll call billable hits. So essentially, your caseworker person comes in, they say, I'm employed at Walmart, and they don't have verification of wages, so you ping Equifax, the work number, and bingo, they've got wages from Walmart. That's a billable hit. If you ping and they don't work there, they don't have anything, that doesn't count towards it. So up until June 30th, 2016, last week, this was a service that, irregardless of the number of billable hits, it was still a fixed amount per month and cost allocated across programs. And the greatest utilization, by the way, is food nutrition services, I think followed, David, by Medicaid probably. And then child support and Work First, less numbers. Now, where we are is negotiating, and we are still negotiating. We've been doing this for several months. What Equifax will be doing starting July 1 going forward is they will charge a monthly fee based on the number of billable hits. It will not be unlimited. And they have a range based on the number of billable hits per year as to what that monthly amount would be. Suffice it to say that Equifax is quite proud of their product because they are, well, they're giving us no choice, basically, other than a significant increase. Just to give you an idea, the number of billable hits from about 2 or 3 years ago went from 300 and some thousand per year to over 600,000 per year. That could be a couple of reasons. They have perhaps increased the number of employers that they have, which would increase the percentage of billable hits. But mostly we think it's because there's more activity perhaps from the caseworker level. Are there more people that are working? If they are, that you ping, then there would be more billable hits. One of the issues we have is to try to determine how counties are using the service. Certainly it's important. It's important to keep doing it. And in the sense of it helps get the information that you need to verify eligibility, certainly it supports same-day processing. It certainly supports everything we're doing in food, nutrition, and Medicaid in relation to timeliness. So it's critical that we do this. So where we are is we're looking to maybe negotiate a bridge, a short-term agreement with them while we work out maybe a longer-term agreement. And suffice it to say, the problem that we face here at the state is that this is going to be an increase in cost, and we don't have the money to pay for the increase in cost. So we're going to be working with the County Directors Association and probably with the Economic Services Committee to kind of talk about what we might do to, you know, how are we using this? Are your staff using it appropriately and judiciously? If you have one worker that pings it, then it's available to you in the system. Or if you have different workers for different programs, you may be hitting it once for Work First and once for FNS or, you know, that sort of thing. So we want to kind of ascertain if we're using it appropriately. So my advice to you, I think, would be to check with your program staff and determine how are your folks using the work number. If someone, David, brings in verification of wages and you have what you need, then there's not a need to ping the add another hit, which is going to be a costly process. So that's kind of where we are. I guess making a decision going forward, we might look at checking out other states to see what they're doing. Are there any other companies? Again, what we understand is this is the, you know, there's no use contracting with a company that may have 20% of employers when we're working with a company that may have 55 or 60% of potential employers in North Carolina. So that's kind of where we are. David, anything you want to add?
No, I think that one of the other issues I would just add, though, is that, you know, keep in mind is, many counties are trying to do universal, and some counties are and some are not. We also believe that there's been an increase in the number of hits based on different programs. If an individual applies for FNS and then applies for Medicaid, we believe that the Equifax has been pinged twice for the same information by different workers. So it's important that whoever pings that information first, that information should be in the evidence in NCFAS. So we're asking that you go out and look for that information in the evidence before you just arbitrarily submit another hit to Equifax.
We will. We are going to be requesting from them if they can provide data on the number of pings and, well, hits, billable hits per county, so that we can identify, you know, a range outside the norm of overutilizers or underutilizers, so we can help with that process. We'll be working together on this, but again, ideally what we want to do is assure that we're using the resource appropriately and that the numbers, again, they've increased substantially, almost doubled in the last 2 or 3 years. Mm-hmm. And, you know, look at if we can keep the cost down but still use the service, or if we can't keep the cost down, then we're going to have to look at a funding mechanism. Yes.
A couple of questions. Thanks for this information. Will the system continue to be available in the interim?
Yeah, system still available. We've worked out a short-term plan with them. And, you know, we may have a, I can't go too much detail because we're still working with them about it, but the system will continue.
And another just, I think it's an observation. We've been cited for an error in case reviews when you used actual wages instead of using online verifications. We use online resources whenever available. Understood that this was what was expected based on the ex parte reviews and using the client information as last resort.
You're right. That's correct.
That applies to Medicaid.
That applies to Medicaid.
Okay. So I think that is a program-specific question. Yeah. I would encourage you to reach out to OST with that question.
So just a heads up, we're working on this. We'll be having conversations, and, you know, I think we don't want to discourage it being used. We still got to focus. I've had conversation with our federal USDA, and certainly CMS would be in the same boat about this in terms of position, and we mentioned the increase in cost, and of course, USDA serves 50% for those that are FNS, and the regional office director assured me that they had no problem paying their share, and that they feel like it's a valuable tool, and we do too. Okay. All right. Thank you, David. Moving on, let's see. Medicaid and Medicaid transportation. Betty, anything else from you? Come on down.
Just one more other question that just came back through while Betty's getting ready. Will you be discussing with the General Assembly about this being included in the 17-19 budget? What's meant 17-18 budget?
17-19 biennium. Yeah, I think we're looking ahead to see what you know what we need to do. I think we're looking at a short term, maybe a bridge agreement, and coming up with a longer term mm-hmm. contract at a later time.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Medicaid just had one additional information to share, and that is on auto newborns. I know Carolyn has mentioned this to counties previously. But we need to be processing those newborns within 5 days. Believe policy states authorize the newborn within 5 work days of receipt of the name and document the case record with the date the name is received. We have providers, again, not being paid for the delivery. There is no newborn in the NC Track system, and it's still pending over in NC Fast with the county workers. And we're talking about months. So DMA has asked NC Fast for a report with information so that we can identify if this is an isolated issue or does it affect all 100 counties. We hope to have that report from NC Fast within the next 30 days. That's all for Medicaid. Any questions about any MT or just let me know. Thank you.
Thank you, Betty. Mm-hmm. Okay, moving on. Operational Support Team updates. Barbara Daniels.
Hello, everyone. Regarding the Work Support Strategies Resource Library, we do have a DCDL that is available on the Division of Social Services website that gives detailed information regarding the lending library. The lending library does include books regarding change management, leadership, and the basics of lean methodology. So we are requesting or hoping that you would go out and request some of the books. We have 4 of each book that is available, and we do appreciate the Directors Association for partnering with us because that will be our means for you receiving the books and the books being delivered back to us. So please reference the DCDL that is available regarding the Work Support Strategies Lending Library. We appreciate the positive reviews that we have been receiving regarding the lean projects that we have already implemented in various counties. We currently have 11 projects that are in process, so we welcome any more. Please reach out to me or Regina Bell if you do have a desire for lean in your county. County consultation visits, OST has been reaching out to counties and performing visits, and we will continue to schedule those visits. We have developed a risk assessment tool that will allow OST to determine when and what type of visit should be needed. The new tool is currently under review by our division partners, so we hope to have that tool available to our staff by the end of this month. We've also reassigned our counties for a more regionalized approach. So this county assignment is effective August 1st. This will not in any way affect the way that you submit your policy questions. We ask that you continue to use our listserv for submitting your policy questions, but we have reassigned counties to make for a more regionalized approach. On Medicaid and FNS note, I just want to reiterate what Betty has mentioned regarding the Medicaid untimely applications as well as recertifications. OST will continue to reach out to counties who are not meeting FNS processing goals as well as have outstanding or untimely Medicaid applications or untimely recertifications. And I think that's all that we have, Wayne.
Okay. Any questions?
No questions.
Thank you much. Moving right along. NC Fast Updates, Angela Taylor.
All right, so I'll be very quick so we can go on and move down to the other agenda items. Just some quick things for our operation and maintenance for NC Fast. As most of you know, last release in June, we actually implemented transitional Medicaid, and we put in Provider Portal, which provider management was implemented for the linking for the counties that will be covered as part of P3 in a few minutes. And then we also, for this coming release, which is this coming weekend, we will also be turning on that provider portal. And, again, we'll cover that in a few moments. Also, some other things that are going, as we discussed earlier, David mentioned that we have the 77 counties that rolled out with ABOG last Friday. We have 23 high defects that we're targeting for this coming weekend's release. Some of those also have some releases for P9, which will be some updates for the 8110 form. This will provide some additional features for Medicaid, special assistance in-home, and cash assistant products. That does exclude SDX, emergency, and forced. But caseworkers will still continue to select the reason code and the outcome as part of that modal, but we're trying to add some additional features there. The system also will now calculate the amount for the PML and the payment amount and the effective date, so that will start showing up after the release this weekend. And then lastly, for that 8110 Phase 1, additional updates for validations will also be put in to prevent incorrect reason code selections for those notices, so we're matching those up a little bit more tightly. We're also doing some updates for the account transfer. Again, that is our link between NCFAST and the healthcare.gov. They've got some updates that they're requiring us to do as part of CMS. And we also are updating our enterprise service bus, which is the enterprise service bus, as most of you realize, is what OVS uses to go out and hit all of those other systems. So we're having to upgrade that to the next version. Also, we're continuing to work with our help desk and making some adjustments and updates there. We're continuing to enhance our Tier 1 and Tier 2. We also are doing what we call blitz on Tier 3. So as we work down the tickets out of Tier 1 and Tier 2, the more complex tickets are moving to Tier 3, which is more of our technical side. We're pulling programmers over to assist with that team so that we can get those down. We will be sending out a survey in the next few weeks to our points of contact and our county champions to get some feedback on how we're doing with the help desk and anything, any other additional improvements that that your teams feel need to be there. So be looking for that to come. And then, as Wayne said, we are working with DSS and DMA to look at, you know, some of these things that have come through through the budget and some of the different sessions information and that has been added. And we'll be providing some additional updates as we work through those with NCFAST with some timelines to come. So with that, that's all I have as far as the O&M updates.
Okay. Thank you, Angie.
All right, moving on. Here from updates on child care subsidy services by Kim Miller.
Good morning, everybody. In recent months, you've been used to seeing Jennifer Johnson coming here and giving you the report. I do have two staffing updates. One of those is that Jennifer Johnson has left DCDEE. She was afforded a wonderful opportunity to go to Connecticut and head up the Quality Rating Improvement System project there, which is a new requirement for CCDF. And then also want to introduce, although she's not on camera, she is here in the room with us, Elizabeth Everett. She is our new policy manager. So that was a position that we got in the budget last year, and so we have been able to fill that position. So we are very happy to have her on board, and she will be doing all of those policy-related things. So you may be hearing from Elizabeth in future months until we get a new assistant director of programs and educational services. We are planning to replace Jennifer's position. So let me start with program updates. We are in process, actually, for the Regulatory Reform Act with our subsidy rules. Subsidy rules, as you know, go through the Social Services Commission, not the Child Care Commission. We did ask for the maximum amount of time because we were also doing CCDF work at the same time, and we were granted until 2019 to finish our regulatory reform review. So we are actively starting on that. We will be submitting a proposal for the Social Services Institute to talk about child care policies because there have been so many changes and updates. We want to make sure that we do review all of those with you. We are also working on some rule changes for overpayments, fraud, sanctions, that whole piece, non-compliance by providers. We're hoping to get those before the Social Services Commission by the end of the year. It is a long process for rule adoption through the Social Services Commission, so we can't really predict how long that will take, but we do hope to get those before the commission, at least by their December meeting, if not before then. We are, as you know, working with proposed regulations for our CCDF grant that was reauthorized back in 2014. Those proposed regulations have a number of provisions in them that are very interesting to us. One of those is that if a family is found to be, and these are not final, these are proposed, but they are of great interest to us, as I stated, that if a family is found to have an inadvertent error as a result of maybe not reporting or having some circumstance that would make them ineligible, but they didn't report that, that would not be pursued against the family, that it would be perceived to place a hardship on the family, and that we would not go against families to try to recoup funds for that. We also see that there is a possibility that we will not be able to react to changes in income during the eligibility period and change fees. That's a possibility. Also, we have announced a 90-day phase-out period, which went into effect on June 1. It seems to indicate that the phase-out period would be a minimum of 12 months. So these are, as I said, of great interest to us. We will be watching what happens with those. If those items do come to be in the final rule, we will have to do some additional rulemaking changes through the Social Services Commission and, of course, make policy changes to our subsidy policies. Wanted to just touch base on 4E claiming. PCG helps us, as you know, with our 4E claiming. There is going to be a quality assurance review in four counties, Wake, Guilford, New Hanover, and Mecklenburg. And those are going to take place in August, between August 8th and August 25th. There is a letter dated, this is from Janice, dated July 11th to those directors who are going to be affected. And we ask, of course, that there is a room prepared. All the instructions are in the letter. They will do simultaneous review of the child welfare information, the foster care information, as well as the child care subsidy information, all at the same time. So there's a lot to prepare. We are having a visit from Region 4 next week, and on the 11th and 12th. This is a TA visit. There will not be any monitoring taking place, but they are coming out to visit us and see what we're doing, and so we're glad to have them coming in. Just a touch on a policy issue is the graduated phase out that did go into effect. We have asked you to do your 90-day clock manually. Our programmer continues to work on getting that 90-day clock installed into SCCRS. As you know, we're moving into NCFAS, so anything that's being done in SCCRS is being done on really an as-needed, urgent basis, and so we are trying to get that addressed. I also will report on improper payments. As you know, this was our third time that we did this. Our final report was due on June 30th. It was submitted. We did see an increase in our error percentage from previous years. Our last error rate was 2.17. Our current error rate is 6.52%. Our goal for ourselves was 5%, so we did not meet that. However, we will not be required to turn in a corrective action plan with CCDF because the threshold for that is 10%, so we are within that threshold. But we do see there are 18 error records, and if you had an error record, you did get a report on that. You are reminded that you would have to make corrections on these cases to the point of origin, so we don't know exactly how much money will be recovered by the time we get all of the point of origin corrections in. We did cite several factors that impacted the whole process of child care subsidy, those being the lack of field staff who were deployed to OST and deployed to NCFAST. We cited the introduction of the IM in 2013, which did include some changes to subsidized child care policies that were not trained on. We do also talked about risk and our risk assessment that we do, and I did want to say that of 15 agencies, 7 of those agencies had a high risk for staff turnover. So we do see that staff turnover also affected the error rate. So we do have a corrective action plan that we will be doing for ourselves and what is going to be involved in that. Part of that is going to be OST taking over support for child care subsidy as it rolls out in NCFAS. That's one item. And the other item that was a big problem was rate entry by county workers. And the NCFAS product has the providers entering their rates themselves. That's a self-managed process through NCFAS, so there will no longer be that clerical error. If a clerical error is made, it would be made by the provider in their own entry of rates, and we do have a back office way to change those and correct them if that should happen. But we expect to see those two problems, those two items, be remediated with these two new changes that will come about with NCFAS. And let me see what else. Waiting list survey, we did send that out in April. The deadline for responses is July 15th. If your staff have not responded, please have them do so. We have received responses from 44 counties. Of those 44, 12 had no waiting list. Counties with a waiting list, 12 of those 25 had no waiting list. Even if you are in the category that has no waiting list or a waiting list that's less than 4 months old, we still need to hear from you, and we will be pursuing you if you do not go ahead and respond to that. And then NCFAS, Angela touched on some of these. The provider portal is live. It will go up for all providers on July 11th is when providers will be able to access it. They will be able to start enrolling and entering their rates at that time. There is linking going on in the counties, linking the provider's NCID to the provider's account, and that will enable us to move forward. Counties are also encouraging providers to go ahead and do their enrollment with FIS with their banking information so that they can get paid when we start rolling out payment. And I don't know if Angela maybe is going to provide any further information, but if there are questions about NCFAS between us, we can answer them. And then the only other thing I have is two reminders, and one of those reminders is that if you do have staff changes, we ask that you send them to us, and you can send them directly to Celeste Pleasant. If anyone needs her information, we'll be happy to provide them. Is to remind you that if you have any investigations starting for overpayments or fraud or any noncompliance issues with providers that are being investigated, it is a requirement to notify DCDEE when you initiate that investigation. And then we will be in contact with you and see you through that process and help you through that process. So that is what I have to tell you about today. It was pretty much a lot, but
There's one question that came through. Would you provide an update on the child support requirement for subsidy eligibility? NCAC DSS has long supported this requirement.
We do have an estimate. I don't know if Angela, if you're still on the line, if you want to comment on that, but we do have an estimate for that.
Hey, Kim, this is David. I'm not aware of any current conversations related to the design of incorporating that upstairs on the project at this point in time. So you guys might have more of the latest information at DCD. We can go back and clarify. I'll check with the business team here and see if they've had any further conversations.
Okay. We'll
get that, and I think that's a good question, and we'll include this as report out next month.
Yes, that'd be great. That'd be great to do that next month. One more.
Do you have any recent caseload standards for a child care social worker caseload?
We do not. That is something that CCDF has not ever encouraged us to create. It does vary greatly by county of how counties have things set up. If you have integrated eligibility workers, universal, if you have a child care unit that also does their payment processing, it just varies so much from county to county that we have no standards for that and have not been encouraged, and there are no federal standards in place for that. Anything else?
No.
Okay, great.
Thank you, Kim. Okay, let's see. David, do you have a quick energy update?
Just 30 seconds.
Take on. Maybe a minute. So just real quickly, SIP, we did put out $5 million into the SIP system on Tuesday. The total allocation for the state fiscal year is $37 million, which is about $3-4 million less than last year. The administration funds will be available once the budget is signed and certified by the governor, so we're waiting for that. And then once that happens as well, then we will issue the remainder of the SIP allocation.
That's it. Questions?
None? P3 update, Angela Taylor or David Chubbikini?
Good morning. This is David. I can give a quick P3 update, at least on topics that haven't been touched on already by Angie and Kim. What you're seeing on the slide here is our overall timeline. So we've already spoken a lot about Release 1, which is the enablement of provider management and the provider portal. The provider portal, as mentioned, will go into production, well, went into production, but will enable access over this coming weekend for any provider that has been linked by the county. You can see in the timeline that we're still tracking for Release 2 in the fall, and then our energy programs are moving through functional design and still targeted for a spring release of the energy programs, obviously with more detail to come on exactly how we'll be looking to implement that once we roll around to 2017. So not much change in terms of action timeline since we've spoken last. We've just, you know, progressed another month and are now at the point where we're going to be enabling access to the portal for the first time. Related to that, and it's probably the topic of what I'll cover next, is basically the NCID linking process that's required. So I've actually been tracking this pretty closely. Our pilots have done a good job linking NCIDs for their providers. I know, and I've been looking at the attendee list here that we've got our pilots on, so I want to say thank you to them for doing that. We do still have a handful of providers in the pilot counties that need to be linked. And I sent the P3 County Champions all a message last night with the list that I think still remain. Not too many, and obviously this process isn't too time-consuming for any one provider, but I would request that the pilot counties please check back with your county champions and make sure that they got that message from me last night to do the linking. There are going to be some other counties contacted with requests to get some providers linked as quickly as possible, and these are providers that have or care for children from the pilot counties. Messages were sent out to these counties maybe a week or so ago with requests to have them link the providers by this coming weekend so that these providers can go in and enroll next week. Some of those providers have successfully been linked. Some have not. So my staff here, they're going to be following up with phone calls and emails today to try to, check in and communicate that anybody can has what they need in terms of the training and access to be able to link the providers, hopefully so that all of the providers related to pilot counties are linked successfully before the weekend, so that if any of them start on Monday, they should be able to get in and do enrollment. And just as a reminder, all of the materials related to NCID linking, that all of our training materials are posted in the Learning Gateway. So if your folks need to take that, it's all available and it can be accessed, you know, where all of our other course materials are. And they should all be able to get in and access that information. With the coming of July, the NCID linking is now actually open to all 100 counties, and I actually looked at a report yesterday and have seen a few that have dove in headfirst, having linked over 50 providers. We've got four or five counties that are well on their way. Just a shout out to a couple of Johnson. I think I saw you had 72 yesterday, Henderson at 49. So diving in and really appreciate your effort getting in and working to get those providers linked as quickly as possible. But all counties should be able to go do this now, and the materials and resources that train all the individuals that are involved in this process are posted. If you have any challenges with them getting that information, just please reach out to us. On the next slide is sort of an overall cascading timeline. We've been referencing this as we've moved throughout our sort of preparation period, but what we're targeting for July is that our all counties can do NCID linking if needed, but our target was to have all of the pilot providers linked so that on Monday those providers can start doing their enrollment, and then we're going to cascade that for the next couple of months. So in August, the phase one providers will look to do enrollment, and then in September, the phase two providers will look to do enrollment. That obviously gets us ready and prepared for the release two coming in October, where we'll then be looking to move cases into NCFAST from SECRS. So no change to our sort of rolling and cascading implementation here, just a big weekend with the first enablement of the provider portal. And we'll definitely be checking in with our pilot counties to see if there are any questions or anything we need to look into related to the enrollment piece next week. A few other reminders just on the next slide. As I mentioned, all the training materials are related to provider management are posted. The materials that are available for providers, our provider gets access to the provider portal next week. They'll actually be able to see and access all the reference material that they need right there within the portal that will show them the processes and walk them through the steps that they need to complete. But we know that your staff might want to view this material as well, so that material is also available in the Learning Gateway if they want to review that. And then lastly, the provider help desk is up and operational. They've been taking phone calls for a couple of weeks. Just a reminder that this is a separate phone number from the regular NCFAST help desk, so it's 919-813-5460, as you can see here. This is the place where the providers will call if they have any challenges with enrollment, but also where anybody that's doing a provider management function, working with NCIDs or doing back office enrollments if that's required, this is where they should reach out for help, as these are the individuals that are trained in those areas and have that knowledge and should be able to provide support with those processes. So a big thanks to all the counties for all the NCID linking. As I mentioned, if you're one of the pilots, thank you for your efforts and thank you for the feedback on the job aids and things of that we received. If you could go ahead and try to link those last few providers, that would be great. And then if anybody else has a provider that works with pilot county children, if you would please make sure you try to have those providers linked prior to this weekend, we'd really appreciate it. And again, folks from NCFAST should be reaching out to you today and tomorrow to just check in on that process. And if there are any other questions, I can take them now.
No questions.
All
There was one, but you'd already answered it. Thanks.
Okay, very good.
Okay, great.
Thank you, David. All right, we're going to move on. Child Welfare Services. We'll give it to Kevin Kelly.
Good morning, everyone, and thanks for the marathon session. I know you're hanging in there. Wayne talked about a lot of the legislative increases that we are seeing in child welfare for the upcoming year. I wanted to point out there were also five requests that the department put forward just to clean up some of the issues that we were seeing with statutes related to the provision of child welfare services. Again, these are not huge, but I think in some ways they're very important. I'll hit some of the high spots. We asked and the General Assembly approved a slight revision to the definition of caretaker to include a potential adoptive parent during a visit for trial placement with a juvenile in the custody of the department, and it goes on under the regular definition of caretaker. And the reason we did that is last year we had an incident where an individual was suspected of maltreating a child, but did not fit under the legal definition because he was not licensed as a foster parent, but the child was placed with him, or I should say was visiting with this individual in anticipation of an adoption. So we revised that caretaker definition. Now those individuals during those trial visits will be considered caretakers as well and can be subject to an assessment process. Similarly, we revised 7B302 to include information for children placed with a private child placing agency, and as you can tell, that stems from that very same incident. Also requested 7B401 to be modified. This was really a situation where the caretaker was allowed to intervene in court. So we're talking about parents. They were already named. In this case, the definition of caretaker went back to that earlier, very broad definition of all those individuals that may be subject to an assessment, and we feel that was inappropriate in some instances. 7B505 is cleaned up just a little bit in terms of language around authorization and consent. That was really just a technical correction made there, as well as in 7B901 about when, again, intervention could be made. And then lastly, I want to point out 7B906 was modified to, again, make it more clear as to when reunification services were necessary and when they were not. As we all know, we're moving very rapidly towards ensuring that every child served by the foster care program has a concurrent planning. So that language is also emphasized in 7B906. So that's just a few of the corrections that were made in this session. Again, Wayne spoke, I think, very well about the expansion items that we're going forward with. We're very excited to be able to support counties more deeply with respect to child welfare services. I don't want to forget that the earlier question around Boys and Girls Clubs about what is the total allocation, and according to the General Assembly report, which added another $125,000, that brought up the total net appropriation for Boys and Girls Clubs to $2.6 million. So I know that was a question, so I just wanted to make sure we had that in place. There were a couple of new services being provided, and we will certainly make counties aware of those as those contracts are developed with private agencies. Those are the high spots I have. Any questions? Great.
No questions.
Thank you.
Great. NCFAS P4 updates. Angela?
This is Nitya. Just give you a brief update on P4. So we kicked off the design sessions on June 14th, and as we speak, the first sessions are going on. Counties who are participating, and it's very critical that we get their expert feedback at this stage to make sure we build the right product. We continue with our project management and the planning activities, and we are actively hiring state resources to make sure we have the planned resources on board when we start the building, the development. Data conversion work is ongoing, and we are currently reviewing the options. So hope to present it to ECC soon. Simplification committee, they have done an excellent job reviewing the obsolete BSFs and also standardizing the forms and notices. We get those feedback back to the development team. And we kicked off the mobile device management work group on June 10th and currently working on the policy templates and we will be meeting on a monthly basis. We kicked off the data governance work group on June 27th and we will be actively working with the state and counties on the data update rules and planning to kick off the security work group by July 15th. And the implementation team, they continue to visit the counties to document assist county process flows. They have visited 11 counties so far. So that part is going good. So far, we are getting positive feedback and it's going on track. So any questions?
Questions.
Thank you.
Irina? Thank you, Nan. All right. Other program updates. We do have a few other updates from the Division of Aging Adult Services. I'll ask Joyce Matthews-Smith to share those.
Am I bringing up the rear here? Not quite. Okay, I'll be quick. I know you guys, gosh goodness, I almost hate to come up here with everything that you've heard this morning. Just quickly, a few things. The Social Services Commission did pass our recommended revisions to the special assistance rules. I believe we sent out that information to supervisors and to the directors. If you have any questions, let us know. Relative to SA and our role in that program, as well as adult protective services and guardianship, and several counties have experienced this directly, we are experiencing a good number of adult care home closures that are either, you know, the sudden closure, which we've got a procedure and policy for, or they're voluntary closures, and we are working to develop some protocol for working with counties and DHSR and the Division of Mental Health, because a lot of these facilities that are closing tend to have populations of persons with serious mental illness. And relocation and transitions to community living are all part of that work. And what we want to say is that the sudden closure procedures are just that. They are for would be a disaster situation, or somebody decides that they're not coming back to, run the facility and folks have to go within a matter of hours. And then the other voluntary closure process, we've said that counties can use the resident discharge team process, but that's a little out there for us to do some of these things. So just to say that we're going to try to develop some procedures that will help us in terms of sharing information about SA recipients to the home counties, as well as working with guardians, and it's, you know, taking into account the need to have the LME MCO doing the in-reach for transition. And I would just say thank you to those counties who've experienced this and have worked very hard. We are in the middle of this in a county now, and we're working over the weekend to get folks placed. So our partners, both at the county and the department, with HHS and HSR and mental health, and we will get word out to you on kind of how we want to go about doing that. The other thing I wanted to mention around adult protective services, we have clarified some policy around residency, and it was in your June director's newsletter. We will be providing training, three webinars beginning at the end of July and early August, and the change notice will go out early August so that counties will know what they need to do to implement this. And this is particularly of a concern for counties who have large regional hospitals and persons come there from other counties and adult protective services reports are made. There's no change in statute. It's just a clarification of the residency policy. And the APRs, of course, will be speaking to your supervisors about this, and they'll have an opportunity to participate in the webinars. From a staffing perspective, we are getting real close, we hope, to fill in the two APR positions. And so we thank you for your patience, especially in the East and Central, for allowing us to kind of parse out things to get things done in your counties. But we hope to be fully staffed pretty soon with those. We are also in the middle of revising our services monitoring plans. One of the things that we've decided is that we are spending a whole lot of time in your counties, and we're not sure about the outcomes that are resulting in that. And so we are looking at doing some targeted monitoring around specific outcomes related to APS and guardianship, as well as continuing our work with Medicaid administrative claiming and SSBG. But that's to say that we're trying to focus on what it is that's important in terms of outcomes for you guys, and also to give you the kind of, when there is corrective action, that results in overall program improvement. And then finally, be on the lookout. We do an annual APS survey with counties. This is critical information. It's information that you provide on the number of staff performing APS activities, and it also provides us with the number of calls you get relative to APS. And if you will note that the APS register data that your staff completes only accounts for the reports you actually screen in. And so, you know, that it's almost double in some counties in terms of the number of calls you get. And so that's a workload issue, and we've used that information with advocacy groups that are looking to support additional funding for APS. So I hope that you all will make sure that we get that done timely. And then finally, we're working still and getting ready to move forward with the APS work in NCFAST. We finished the program design review amongst ourselves and the IBM staff, and we have the pilot county selected, so we're hoping to get moving forward on that in the new year as we develop APS for that. And the exciting thing about that, some of you may know, is concurrently the Administration for Community Living is implementing a national adult maltreating reporting system called NAMERS, and we are making sure that what we develop in NCFAST is compatible to that, and it at long last will hopefully give us national data to compare ourselves with other states in terms of trends in adult protective services. So we're excited about getting that done, and that is everything I have. Any questions?
No question.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joyce.
I can't believe you can read that writing.
I don't either. Yeah. Anybody that's ever read my writing
right.
will tell you the same thing. All right. One last thing. At the earlier part of the this morning, we had a poll question, and there it is. Has your county utilized processing teams or labs? In other words, you put folks in a room, have them focus on one task, like applications for FNS, for example. So what we got back is 27% have used for regular, that was most frequently, expedited 24%, 20% FN research, Medicaid apps 24%, and Medicaid research. So basically up to a quarter or so of counties are using these processing labs or teams to help get the work done. What we're really, I think, interested in is maybe to what extent counties have done this with a backlog to get caught up versus what counties may be doing to utilize this technique here of having the labs or the processing teams on an ongoing basis as a best practice. And what I'm interested in, if there are any counties that are using this or you found this to be something that beyond just a short-term catch-up kind of a thing, if you're seeing the value of that on an ongoing basis, I'd like to hear from you, because I think we might want counties, a couple counties, to share this as a best practice if you found it to be so on the August 100 director call. Like I said, we had a whole lot of work today to cover all the budget areas, but we'll try to get back to the call in August with a couple of counties reporting on best practices.
We have one more update that just came through.
Okay.
From Carlotta Dixon.
Okay.
She says that the upcoming will be a NCDSS CERT telephone conference call on July the 21st from 2 p.m. until 4 p.m. for county DSS emergency disaster coordinators to prepare for the upcoming sheltering task force kickoff meeting, which will be August the 11th from 10 to 3. That will be in person at the State Emergency Operations Center and by webinar. So just wanted to make sure that you were aware that in your county, your your emergency and disaster coordinators should be ready for those meetings.
It's that time of year.
Absolutely.
All right, got that. Good information. Anything else? If not, we'll conclude a long session, and thank you much.